Welcome to the Homeschool Show from North Carolinians for Home Education. Our goal is to help you homeschool with confidence and joy. I'm your host, Matthew McDill, and we have once again as our co-host, T.S. and Smack.
Hello again.
How's it going?
It's going good.
Great to see you again.
Yes, love being here.
What do we have today?
So today, another great show, Homeschool News. We have more news about Thrive, the NCHE Homeschool Conference. And then for Homeschool Conversations, we have joining us again here in the studio, Jessica Frierson. She is a secretary on the NCHE board, and she manages and writes for the NCH blog. And she's also one of our workshop speakers at the Thrive Conference. Hello, Jessica. Thank you for joining us again.
Hi. It's great to be back in the studio.
Yes. And then, of course, we have our Homeschool Helps with Amanda. More great tips from Amanda. So let's get into it.
That's right. So homeschool news on the conference. The last week's big news was registration was open. That was on Tuesday the 17th. And now we're going to have the big reveal of all the workshops and speakers for the conference tomorrow, January 24th.
Exciting.
So we already know the featured speakers.
Yes.
But we don't even know yet all of their specific talks.
Yes.
And we're going to have so many more speakers, so many more workshops and talks. It's really exciting. So we'll get to know what's happening there tomorrow. So go to nche.com/thrive to find out more about the conference. And if you haven't, to go ahead and register. So I'm going to let you know right now who our featured speakers are. Dr. Bill Brown is the Senior Fellow of Worldview and Culture at the Colson Center for Christian Worldview and directs the Colson Fellows Program. We have Belinda Bullard. She's the founder of A Blessed Heritage Educational Resources, a leading provider of multicultural history curriculum featuring African-American presence and contribution. We have Kirk Martin. He's the founder of CelebrateCalm.com.
Ooh, that sounds good.
That was
good.
A pretty good.
Yeah, I know.
He's host of Calm Parenting Podcast. What is that?
I know.
Andrew Pudua. He's definitely always a favorite. He's the founder and principal speaker of the Institute for Excellence in Writing. We have Dr. Steve and Megan Scheibner. They've spent the last 20 years developing parenting, grandparenting, and youth character development. And then we have Sonia Schaefer. She's a popular homeschool speaker and writer specializing in the Charlotte Mason Method. And she runs the ministry Simply Charlotte Mason.
I love that.
Those are some great. Have you guys followed any of these guys before?
Yes. I love Simply Charlotte Mason.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. I'm doing their reading program. I like just her videos that she puts out. It helps a new homeschooler really jump in and feel like I can do this. So, yeah. I love Sonia. Excited for that.
That was one of my first homeschool authors that I really followed, was very influenced by Sonia.
Yeah.
I want to hear about this calm parenting thing.
Yeah.
I think I definitely need that one.
That's right. So we had a great interview with Sonia at the Homeschool Leaders Conference, and we aired here on the show a few weeks ago. I hope we can get her on again before the conference. I love listening to Andrew Pudua. We've used Institute for Excellence in Writing and enjoy that curriculum also. So
and of course Belinda Bullard, that Blessed Heritage. Very excited about that. We don't find a lot of multicultural history curriculum, so I think that's going to be a really great thing that's going to be offered at the conference. So really excited about her as well.
And almost all of these are return speakers.
Yeah.
They've really qualified themselves as, hey, please come back.
So yes.
Those are great ones.
We are excited.
So as we head toward the conference, what about you guys on some little tips for how to do the conference
Big tip.
That's cool.
My first conference, I did not stay at the conference hotel.
Okay.
And I had three children by myself. That was not the ideal, right? It was fine.
No,
it was good. We still
not.
Enjoy the conference. But I have a teenager who wants to do the teen things, which are late. I had little ones who needed a nap. And I was like, oh, okay, driving back and forth that 10, 15 minutes, it's not ideal. So big tip, stay at the conference hotel.
It might be a little more expensive, but it's worth it.
It's worth it. It's definitely worth it. So,
And I'm not sure that it actually ends up costing that much more when you have to drive back and forth and you got to deal with the parking. And meals can be so much easier if you are staying on site versus staying away.
You can pack snacks and lunches and
And that's one of my tips is make use of everything you can there at the hotel.
Yes.
Eat the breakfast with them. We actually use the manager's snack in the afternoon for an early dinner. And then just have a snack that we have in the room later on. Bring a crock pot or bring sandwich stuff. Nice. Keep it there in the mini fridge and eat in the room, especially when you have people going in different locations, like the teens are going one way and the younger kids are going another and you're doing your thing. It can be really hard to, I mean, if you're not on site, I'm not even sure how you do it. Another big tip I have is wear comfortable shoes.
There we go.
And dress in layers. Bring a sweater because some of those rooms are hot and then others are freezing, at least for me. And, you know,
all
I feel like
seasons.
I'm experiencing North Carolina weather right here inside, you know. So, and you want to wear those comfortable shoes because you're going to do a lot of walking.
Lots of walking. Yeah. So you can count your steps.
Yeah.
That's a really great perk
That's right.
of the conference.
That's
you get
right.
your steps in mentally and
I would add as a tip to check out the program before you get there.
That's
available online.
Yes.
All the workshops are listed out. And when you're there, it's just hard to like, try to go through everything. Of course, you can go at night in your hotel room. That's good. You can kind of go through it. But that's just one more thing you don't have to do.
Yeah,
you can always go back and switch it up. Once you hear a good speaker, you're like, okay, I'm going to all theirs.
Yeah.
Yes.
But at the same time, you're ahead because you've circled some of the ones you're interested in.
And you know
in,
where you're going next. That's a really good tip. Save some time. Nice.
Okay. Well, let's head right into the homeschool conversation segment. And that's once again why we have Jessica here. Last week, we talked about the workshop she's going to do. As we mentioned, she's also in charge of our NCHE blog and is our main contributor. And so we're going to ask Jessica to talk to us, if you will, about maybe some of your favorite posts, some of your favorite topics that you've had on the blog.
Yeah, sure. Well, you know, I think one of my favorite posts is one that's called Fitting the Mold. And funny thing about that post is it was inspired by a picture that my sister sent me of her butter dish. Okay. And so here's her new butter dish and here's her stick of butter. And they were not compatible. The butter did not fit the mold. Okay. So the lid of the butter dish is sitting on top of the
butter. It's too small.
Okay.
Okay,
it's too small. And I looked at that picture and I thought, wow, that's me.
Wow.
I'm the butter.
You have the revelation and from watching
yes,
the butter.
Yes. And we all are, aren't we? We're all trying to fit into this mold.
Yeah.
And I thought about how, okay, so she's got a few options here with this butter. She could cut off a piece of this butter. Mm. Every stick of butter, when she pulls it out, she can cut off, you know, inch or so to make it fit. And that's what we do a lot of times. We cut off a part of who we are to fit into the mold around us that we think we're supposed to fit
into.
I'll
never look at butter the same. It's so deep. I love it.
And now another option, be a lot more work, is she could make her own butter and make it into an entirely different shape to fit that, right? Now, we make butter ourselves at home, and it's not that hard to make
really?
Butter. Well,
we do. Feel bad for laughing now?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, we're over here.
We're like,
hey, if you have small kids and they need an activity to do while you're doing teaching them something, you put some cream, heavy cream in a jar, and they just shake. Shake. Okay. In a little while, you got butter.
Okay.
So she could do this, right?
Okay.
She could totally remake herself. This is how I'm thinking, like, as what we do as homeschool families. Sometimes we look at this mold around us in the homeschool community and we totally reshape who we are to fit that mold.
Wow.
That's not really a good solution for us, and it's not for the butter either.
Yeah.
Really, the truth is that mold is not the right one for her.
Okay.
She needs to throw away the mold, right?
Yeah.
And so I'm really thinking about this, and we are all unique individuals that God has created. And the Bible tells us not to be conformed to this world, not to fit into the molds that are there. We're to be transformed by the renewing of our minds, right? Mm-hmm. And so I think in the homeschool community, whether you're just starting out and you're looking for your place to fit, or if you've been there a long time, you get to a point where you realize you're not really fitting the mold. You know, maybe you're not the family that, you know, is doing all the nature walks, and like, you're hearing all this nature walks. So that's something our family actually does enjoy doing a lot. But it's not for everyone, right? Or maybe you're looking at, you know, for us, one thing that really was a struggle for a few years for me until I realized I don't need to fit this mold was there was a season where all of my teens' friends, all their peers that were homeschooled, were doing dual enrollment. And when my son was graduating, he was having his hard-earned homeschool diploma, and all of his peers were having their homeschool diploma and their their college thing as well. They're doing the dual enrollment. So they're ending homeschool with also a college degree. And so my son felt like he just wasn't good enough, as he wasn't as good as his friends. And there was a lot of pressure on us. And I had visited that option a few years before with one of his siblings, and that's not the thing for us. And I visited again with him, and I said, no, that's not the thing for us. We didn't need to fit into someone else's mold. That was their thing, wasn't our thing. You know, when we visit co-ops, sometimes you just click, and sometimes you don't. You shouldn't change yourself and who you are or your approach to homeschooling to fit in anyone else's mold. And so looking at this picture of this butter dish, it was just so profound to me. Like, this is what we do. This is a picture of our lives so much. And there was a song that it had really been on my mind that week that kind of went along with this. It's a song by Matthew West, and he says, lie number one is that basically you are supposed to fit everyone else's expectations, and lie number two is that everyone's life is perfect except yours. And those are both flat out lies, right? But we see, especially with social media these days, we see the pictures of the airbrushed home. You know, just like you see the airbrushed model. Well, it's, you know, someone's taking a picture of what they want you to see. And that's with homeschooling as well as anything else. There's no perfect day, right? You know, and we think that, oh, if I just got this all together, I could be as good as that. I could fit that mold. And that's a lie. There is no perfect home. There's no perfect day. There's no perfect homeschool. There's no perfect moms. No perfect family. We're all imperfect, and we need to be who God's made us to be. And so the next part of that song is, I say I'm okay. Hey, it's okay. Everything's okay. But it's not. The truth is I'm broken. And, you know, I think I have it all together, but I don't. And so that's where I think a lot of us are, maybe all of us are, is that we go around, and, you know, it's such an American thing. If I say to you, Tia, hey, how are you?
Fine.
We all know what to do, right? That's the routine. That's what you're supposed to say. And it just kind of goes against me the wrong way every time I say it, because sometimes I am, but a lot of times I'm not. And so you know, if you say the truth, you realize right away that they didn't want the truth.
I'm not asking you how you are.
Didn't you read the script? You're supposed to say fine, right? That's what you're supposed to say. And we're not. You know, everyone's life isn't perfect. No one's is. And so we have this mold we're trying to fit into. And the truth is, we can't be who we are designed to be if we're trying to be anything else.
Absolutely.
Right? And so that's one of my favorite blogs. It's just that one of just be who you're supposed to be, and let your family be who they're supposed to be. Your homeschool be your unique school for your unique family.
I love that. And I love that it's centered on butter, because seriously, every time now I open my refrigerator, I'm going to be like, no, Tia, since like, be you.
That's right.
I love that. That's so good.
I love that it's centered on butter because it's delicious. But I also want to add in.
Because I like butter.
I like butter. But I just want to add in. How do we decide what we're supposed to be? And maybe we can talk a little more about that, because I was recently processing a decision I needed to make.
Okay.
And I'm thinking about it, right? And I think I'm thinking about it.
Yeah.
I think I'm pros and cons and blah, blah, blah. But realize what I was really doing was making a list of who liked it and who didn't like it.
Yes. Yeah.
I was like, Dana thinks this, and so-and-so thinks this, and my kids think this, and I think this. And it's like, but what does that really have to do with any of it, even what I want? You know, because we don't want, as you know, we don't want to turn this into, hey, I'm butter, this is my size. You know, like,
yeah,
y'all can just stick it. You know, that's not really the same attitude.
I can't.
But it has to be something like, Lord, what do you want me to be? Because the reality is, he might not have, he might have to cut off a little bit.
This
you know,
is
we
true.
Know the Father is pruning and like, okay, this part actually is going to go. And so anyway, the point is we don't accept the mold from other people, from the world, from a curriculum, from comparison. We don't even accept it from ourselves.
Right.
Because we may be putting pressure on ourselves in ways that we shouldn't be. And we may not be putting pressure on ourselves the ways we should be, that we do need to change. So we're looking to the Lord. Lord, how do you want me to grow? How do you want me to change? And how have you made me? So that's another important part of the journey.
And that's where that second part of that verse comes into play,
I think, is
don't be conformed to the world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind.
Yeah.
And how is our mind renewed? Is that time with the Lord every day, that time in His Word, in a praying and hearing from Him what we should be doing. Because our minds really do need to be transformed. And like you said, it's a subtle little thing that when we even think we're, you know, doing things the right way, and then we realize, oh, you know, I'm assessing the wrong factors here. And so that's great, Matthew. And you know, I've had a similar thing happen to me recently as well, of thinking through and realizing, okay, this is, I'm just thinking everyone else
I'm
is going to see
poll.
This. Yes,
I'm taking
right.
a poll in my
that's
mind.
Right.
So here's a question. I know one of your other blog posts recently has been the beginning of the end, right?
Yes.
So starting one of your last ones through. So we can transition into that, but I do want to see if either of you have some mom thoughts on this. You just mentioned the importance of spending time with the Lord. And that's where we hear from the Lord, and how does fruit get born, as I was referring to the vine and the branches in John 15, by being connected to Jesus.
Yeah.
That's
right.
How. So, but one of the big things is moms don't have time to spend time with the Lord. How do you guys wrestle with that in your life?
I know for me, sometimes like it constantly changes. Like sometimes that might be at night while I'm nursing my baby, or sometimes that might be, you know, if the nights get busy, then it might be in the morning. Sometimes, a lot of times I listen to it, put on my AirPod, and I just kind of wherever I feel like God is leading me, and I just play it. And I might play the same chapter over and over, so I really get it in, because I'm listening and doing. And then sometimes just praying, you know, like, Lord, help me. And just knowing. And that's what I love about God, is that He hears me and He sees me. And He's with me. And He doesn't say, if you don't have 34 minutes for me before those kids get up, forget it. Like that's not who He is. He's like, come to me however you are, wherever you are. And I'm right there.
The
and that's what makes Him. I always say that's what makes Him worthy of the love and of everything, because He already just loves me just like this. So
that's so good. He sees us where we are, and He meets us there,
and He's right there. Like,
and I think
it.
That flexibility, that we just, you know, if it's in our heart, if it's our deep desire to spend that time with the Lord, we will find those little moments through the day. My years of having little ones were the years that I had the longest time segments, and more frequently, because again, like you said, there's times nursing that baby, everyone else is off doing something else, and you need quiet to get that baby to sleep. And I realize, you know, whenever I have a baby growing into toddlerhood and all that, oh, I don't have that that moment anymore. I really miss that. And then I had to find other ways to do it. And you do. You just have to carve it into your day here and there. And if it's a priority to you, you'll find those moments. And I think it's important not to, you know, beat yourself up over it and feel like you have, again, back to, you know, fitting the mold. You have to do what you see someone else doing.
Yes. You don't need an hour quiet time. So you don't have to get up at 4 o'clock, because if I got up at 4 o'clock, my poor children would suffer. I would be very, very sad.
Wouldn't be a good day.
So a little bit in our time together, tell us about the beginning of the end. What does that mean? And and share a little bit about that.
Well, my youngest turned 7 just recently.
Oh, my goodness.
And so now it's my last official student who's officially on the roll books.
And tell us how many you have, because everyone
doesn't have
enough.
10.
Wow.
And so I've been homeschooling since the fall of 2000.
Wow.
So, and we don't officially start your school until they're 7.
Yes.
And so in that blog post, I just reflect back on the years that I've been homeschooling. Quite a few years, a couple of decades, and the time I have ahead, how I've made changes and the things that have worked over the years. And some things we come full circle. You know, we went this way and we come, you know, make a few little side trails and then, you know, actually, this is what's working for us now. And I just talk about those, you know, that long time frame of homeschooling, the different paths we've taken and where we are now.
Can you share one thing that you would, I don't know, one reflection of that would just benefit someone who's at the beginning from your position kind of at the end?
Well, I would say the one thing would be is adapt to where you are.
Okay.
And don't feel pressured. I mean, it's the same thing.
To fit the mold.
Don't feel pressured. Where you are at that moment is where you need to fit into that. Those circumstances with your schedule, your schooling, everything.
That's awesome. Well, thank you so much, Jessica.
I just want to mention nchg.com/blog.
Yes.
Okay, so you can read about this one and other ones like it.
Absolutely. So we are now going to hear from Homeschool Helps with Amanda.
Welcome to Homeschool Helps with Amanda. I'm Amanda Wares, Homeschool Helps Director with NCHE. Today, we are going to talk about something that is coming for all of us, or maybe almost all of us. I know I have experienced it so many times over my 18 years of homeschooling, and I have talked to many, many other homeschool parents who have also experienced it. What am I talking about? The February slump. Or you might have heard it talked about as the winter doldrums. What happens? The holidays are over. It's a long time until Easter or spring. It's a long, even longer time until summer. The weather's terrible. You're stuck inside more. And it just, sometimes those days and the months of winter, that month of February can feel so very long as a homeschool mom or dad. So what do you do? What do we do during this time when it can feel really tempting to put those little boys and girls on that yellow bus as it goes down the street? What do we do? So my advice is first, just acknowledge the reality that the February slump or the winter doldrums is a real thing. Don't try to fake it till you make it or pretend it away. Just realize that it's a real thing. It happens to almost all of us, and it will be okay. It will pass. You will get to spring. You will get to summer, I promise. Next, I would advise you, when you're feeling that feeling, don't do anything drastic. Like I said, there have been times that I have seen that school bus come down the street and it looked mighty attractive at that moment because I was just tired. Everybody, we were all inside the house all together for so many hours and days at a time, and just, I was tempted to put those little darlings on that school bus. But I would encourage you, this is a temporary feeling. Don't do anything drastic. Last but not least, a solution. Do consider switching things up a little bit. Change your location. Go do school at the library or at a coffee shop. Maybe stay in your pajamas all day if you don't already do that, and or try a unit study, anything that will make things a little more fun and exciting. Take a few more field trips than you would normally anything that can switch things up a little bit, get you out of that doldrum blah feeling, and help you move on and feel a little more excited and renewed and rejuvenated, ready to tackle another day of homeschooling. Last but not least, do remember that this will pass. It is not a permanent feeling, and you are not alone. So many other moms and dads feel this way. So just like it's not going to be winter forever, spring is coming. The same is true in our homeschool. This February slump, it will pass, I promise. So I hope this has been helpful today.
So thank you for joining us this week. We'd love to hear from you. Send your questions and feedback to thehomeschoolshow@nche.com. And please help others find this show by subscribing, rating, and leaving a review on Apple Podcasts and YouTube. And if you think this show will be helpful to your friends and family, please let them know about it. To learn how to subscribe to our show as a podcast and on YouTube, go to nche.com/thehomeschoolshow.
Thanks, Tiessens. Thanks, Jessica.
Yes.
Thanks for being with us today. And until next week, continue to homeschool with confidence and joy.